Hello, hello everyone. Hello again. I would like to say welcome to the new arrivals. Today we'll talk about the impact of vegetation and the new infrastructure within the riverbed with 1D and 2D model. Before we start our study, we define our case study. We will talk according to that. Our work in this topic, results and discussion focused on the riverbed. Here, as we see, we talk about the domain of the study about river bed and the type of vegetation, the type of infrastructure, and the 1D model we use and the 2D. Before we start to run the model, we asked ourselves a few questions. What are the type of the vegetation on the riverbed? What is the infrastructure representing? How can we present this vegetation, different kinds of vegetation on our model to be able to answer the question for us for this week? Here, just to give you roughly about our domain for the 1D and 2D model. For the 1D, we took from downstream to upstream, so almost like 20 kilometers. But for the 2D model, we are not able to take all this length. So we took small part just to be able to answer the question, not to run the model and so on. Based on our literature and some help from our French colleagues, we realized in the riverbed different kinds of vegetation, like as we see in the pictures, like the trees, the bushes, the weeds, the grass, and it's different from place to other, and it's not the same intensity, and there's some of them on the left, some of them on the right, and all of this we realized by our eyes when we were in the field trip in the riverbed. And all, as well for the infrastructure, as we can see here, we can see the sugar groves, the bridge, the vine, and the weir. For 1D model, we use Hecras, and for 2D, we use Eber. And because of the short time, and there's another team talk about the same topic, so we decide to talk in 1D model about for the infrastructure about the weir, and for the 2D model about the bridge and sugar loss, and how we can define it, how we can add the structure in the model, and how we can present the vegetation based on the manic, how we can change it, and so on, and all this stuff. Here, Paula will continue with you.
Okay. Using 1D model Hecras to know the impact of vegetation on the water flow, we use different absorption tool 0.03, 0.05, and 0.08 along on river page. Also for the infrastructure, we use 8 weirs along the channel, as shown with the red arrows. And we find the results with vegetation. For the normal roughness coefficient is 0.05. We get a velocity of 2.49 meters per second, water depth of 8.53 meters. And comparing to this scenario, we increase the roughness coefficient. When we increase the roughness coefficient with 0.08, we get velocity decreased with 36%. Which is 1.59 meters per second, and water depth of 3.1. And this is because when we increase the roughness along the river bed, the water levels will be high and made decrease the velocity. In the other case, when we decrease the roughness to 0.033, we get higher velocity with 50.2% and water depths of 6.41. And considering the wheels, we get the velocity of 3.74 and water depths of 6.41.
Okay, so once my colleague has explained the result that we have obtained for the 1D model, we are going to present the result for the 2D model. We have used the Iber software in order to answer our question for the second week. Firstly, we would like to indicate that the 2D model that we have constructed is a simple model, and we have assumed some hypotheses that will result in some limitations of our model. For example, we have simulated only, as my colleague said, the last 9 kilometers of the Bar River. The resolution of the mess is 50 meters, that for a cross section of 350 meters is not as accurate as it should be. We also have mediated the rainfall that may contribute to this flood event. So how we have run this model is we just consider an inflow that corresponds to the discharge obtained with our previous HEC-HMS calibrated model. So for the flood event of November 1994. With this consideration, we can now have a look at the scenarios that we are comparing this study. So the first scenario that it will be used as the base one reflects the situation without vegetation in the riverbed. We have considered for that a mean value of 0.025. Also, the second scenario pretend to assess the impact of vegetation in the riverbed. So the parameter that we have changed in this case is the mean value. We have increased this value according to a kind of vegetation like trees and also dense brush. The third scenario that we are going to compare with the first one, the only change that we have made in comparison to the first one, if we have had sugar blocks at the banks of the riverbed, so decreasing the manure coefficient. And finally, for the final scenario, for the fourth one, we have added a bridge between the second cross section and the third cross section, and to simulate pillars in the riverbed, we have added an open percentage of 50%, so that's reduced the cross section. So here we present some results of this model. We have analyzed the results at a three cross section of the river. So one in the upstream part, another in the downstream part, close to the sea border, and another in the middle. We present the results at the stream situation, so that means for the peak of the discharge. In this graphic, at the right side, we visualize the water level of each scenario for the upstream cross section. So we have decided to analyze water level because it's one of the main variables related to flood risk. A higher value of water level at the riverbed maybe means also a higher probability of flood risk at the potential flooding area. So we focus our assessment not only in the values obtained, because as we have explained, we have implemented some assumptions that we have limitations, so the values obtained are not the same as the real situation, but we want to analyze the tendency of these values in order to respond to answer our question. So we can observe that the scenario with no vegetation, so the green line, present the lowest water level, the scenario with vegetation is the highest one. There is a difference of 1.5 meters between each case. This observation is consistent with what we expected to obtain. We can also realize that there isn't any important difference between the basic scenario, so with no vegetation, and the scenario that considers sugar blocks at the riverbanks. These results also correspond to our expectative, because these sugar blocks have a small area at the size of the riverbed compared to the whole riverbed. So the change of the managed value doesn't have an important impact. Finally, for the scenario with the ridge situated between the cross section number 2 and the cross section number 3, we can see that water level increase compared to the first scenario, what seems clear because the reduction of the cross section of the downstream part results in an increase of water level at the upstream part.
Okay, in this slide we can talk about the results. The results for the second and the third cross section. In the graphs at the left slide and side, we observe the same behaviors as in the graphs showed before. But the magnitude of these values isn't as important as in the first part. The bigger difference is 0.05 meters. At the right side, we observe that all the scenarios present the same water level. These cuts be explained if we think that this section is already closed to the sea. So the weight increase in the and the change in water level are not significant. So finally, it is important to present also how can vegetation that affects existence within the river bed impact of or affect the potential flooding area while a flood event. In order to address strategy and management actions that could be determined to prevent this kind of catastrophe, we observe now the flood map for the extreme situation of the flood event in both cases with vegetation and without vegetation. The first aspect that we can appreciate is that the flooding area is reduced in the second case. Also, the magnitude of water level decreased for the second one. So, for example, the industrial area situated next to the river bed present a water level of 13 meters, and if we consider the cause without vegetation, that water level decreased 1 meter.
Thank you.
Okay, so for the discussion, we had to evaluate the vegetation impact. So the results we had with both models, we saw that the velocity decreases, which makes the water level increase, and then we have more flood risk in the area. For infrastructures, we consider weirs, which what they do is they increase the water upstream, and because we have upstream sedimentation and downstream erosion. And another effect is that the coarse material is trapped and only fine material can pass. So we get more narrow channels with lateral vegetation, and so these structures also help to increase flood risk. And in the case of the bridge, it also reduces the cross section. So we have a water level increase upstream, and this is very little, but it can help also increase the flood risk. And for sure, blocks, because their function is actually to protect the river banks, and the area of the sugar blocks is really small, they didn't have any effect on the results. So some proposals for action is that seeing how that vegetation should be controlled to prevent future floods, as we see that it does have a big impact, and especially downstream where there's urban area and industries. And in the case of the weirs, they should be considered not only the short term, but also the long term effects, as they were first built without considering the possible sedimentation and the elevation of the water levels and the possible for floods. Sugar blocks don't actually have any effect on the flood events, and their main objective is to protect the river banks. And if we construct bridges, the pillars should be located outside of the river bed in order to avoid water bridges. And thank you.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. Questions? Who wants to start? James.
Thank you for that interesting presentation. My question concerns the vegetation, shown very nicely that it has an effect. I wonder whether you think there is a sufficient change between in the seasons in the level of vegetation that this needs to be taken into account. In other words, when in the winter, when the vegetation dies back, and in the summer when it's growing and has a bigger effect. Do you think that is a significant difference that needs to be accounted for?
Actually, we don't know in the east how the difference between the summer and the winter, because the leaves, we don't know if the leaves are still on the trees in the summer, because for example, in Germany, you know, the trees without leaves in the winter or in the autumn. But actually, I don't know how to answer this. Maybe our French colleague can help us. You know about the, you know, because you are French, right?
So you have a French species, so that's
sorry, I don't know. He's not sure, so he don't know exactly the niche. Maybe someone from his niece can help us a little bit.
Is the main vegetation trees, or are there also rushes?
There is, yeah, different, because of this, we don't know that. Talk about the trees. Yes.
Well, are there rushes? The other vegetation is a lower vegetation called a rush.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the rushes would die back quite significantly in the winter and then be much bigger in the
Okay. That's the opposite.
This is not the reason.
And vegetation is supposed to disappear during summer because it's super dry. Okay? So it's growing during springtime, which is potentially the period where we have high water coming from the melting snow and so on. Okay? So the trees, of course, they remain. So all the old places where we get accumulation of fine sediment, where you get the big trees are remaining. So whatever to say is easy. Okay? More questions? I had, as the microphone came back to me, you showed the results of impact on your 2D model within the cross sections. I think it would have been useful to show how you have distributed the Mannlin coefficient, because honestly, I don't realize how many cells you have in the riverbed and how many of them are concerned with the Mannlin coefficient you are using, and also the sugars. How many cells are you covering for the sugars? One? Two? Because it's extremely narrow.
That is what I tried to explain, that the resolution for the river is too big, so actually that is why the no vegetation case at the reservoir is actually the same because of the resolution of the mesh. We should, for our recommendation should be to do this model with a higher resolution to take in account this sugar blocks, because they are situated at the riverbanks, so it's aligned and compared with the 50 meters of the mesh, it can be negated this case and the other.
Because basically the sugars should have been combined with the cell which is representing the embankment. So
the problem is when we try to run a model with a higher resolution, it takes a lot of time and we needed 4 scenarios, so okay. This is what we could run.
Can you come back to the slide where you show the results for the section 2 and 3? Because there is something I do not... Yes, those ones. Where are the embankments? Somewhere on the left and somewhere on the right? So because I... The black line is supposed to be the...
The cross section, yes.
Okay, so where are the left side and the right side? Where are they?
It's the streams of the graph.
Yeah, but somewhere you should have something which is closing the section, because you
cannot... Yes, but we have no results at the other time. It would be because of the image. So when we extend the cross section, we obtain a clear result.
Okay, but you should have something to represent and to close the section, because if you look at your section 3, I'm not surprised you get difficulties, because of the section 3...
But the section 3 is at the end, like, it's almost the sea part, so it's... And also, it's because the scale, it's so much to see it better, we have... I don't know how to explain this. We have amplified the sketch. So.
Yeah, but I mean, when you present the result, you should show cross section, the real cross section. Because here, I don't see the cross section. I see the water level, but I don't see the cross section. You understand what I mean?
Yes.
Yeah. More questions? Yes, Constantin.
Just a very small question here. When you're drawing the water level, so the simulation that you run are unsteady simulation?
Yeah.
Are they? Okay. And what you're representing is certain instant of time, or it's average time, or what's it? Probably I missed, the water level that you show on the graph corresponds to what time in the simulation?
Did the peak flow?
Yeah, so we have simulated the 3 days event with a time step of 15 minutes, and we are showing the results for the peak. So it's
okay.
In the second day at 10, okay. 15, I don't remember. Sorry if we didn't put this information.
Okay, no, I probably missed it. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you then. Thank you very much. Let's move to the team number 10, please.
We are not team number
10. You were 10, sorry. So the 5. So 5.
Pardon, ça c'est... C'était qui le... Good afternoon, everybody. We are Group 5, and we are presenting on structural measures for flood reduction, management of slope, and management of weirs, including weir removal. This is an assessment done in 1D and 2D hydraulic modeling. And this is the outline. So, the background. Our study area is the Lower Bar River, located in the Bar catchment. And some special characteristics of the Bar catchment are that it's a steep slope, a very powerful river, and it's a high solid trash flow. So, if we zoom in into the Lower River Bar, you will see that it is a 22-kilometer stretch river, and there are 11 weirs. In the 1950s, the riverbed was mined for construction materials, and this lowered the groundwater table. As a result, in the 70s and 80s, weirs were constructed in order to increase the surface elevation of the water and to also increase the groundwater table at a higher elevation. So very briefly, what is a weir? It is a hydraulic structure placed in rivers perpendicular to the flow. To the flow direction, to control flow depth and discharge. They act as a barrier, they raise the water level, and they retain water upstream. So these weirs had unforeseen and negative impacts in the river. The coarse sediment stopped at weir 16, and only light fine sediment was able to flow through. And this resulted in the growth of dense vegetation between weirs 4 and 6. The vegetation narrowed the channel borders, it changed the flow resistance, and reduced the flow velocity. Also, it caused scouring downstream in weir 2 and 3, which caused the weirs to fail in the 1994 flood event. And also, it caused the erosion of the riverbed due to the lack of transport of sediment. So the water management local agencies, they have tried to reverse these negative impacts on the river. And the actions that they have taken are to reduce the weir height for weirs 8, 9, and 10. So our project stems from their effort. Our aim is to take structural measurements of management of weir slope and weir removal. And what we're trying to achieve is reduce the flood risk by increasing the capacity of the river and also restore the natural conditions of the flow and of the transport of sediment. And our methodology, we use 1D MIC 11 and we use 2D MIC 21 modeling, and we used the 2011 flood event, and also the prevention risk inundation plan flow of 4,500 meters cubed per second. And we lowered the weirs by 2 meters, 4 meters, and 6 meters. And we're going to go ahead and present the results.
Okay, for our modeling procedure, here we have three scenarios. Actually, we have three input data. So the first input is the 1994 flood event. Second one is the 2011 flood event. And the third one is the PPRI theoretical flood event with 4,500 cubic meter per second discharge. So for each input data, for each model, so here we have three models. For each model, we did simulation for current situation. Another one by lowering the wear number 5, 6, and 7 by 2 meter. After that, by 4 meter, 6 meter. So we did the same procedure for the three scenarios. And after that, we calculated the capacity of each wear according to our situation and our model. So we have four scenarios for the current one, lowering by 2, lowering by 4, and lowering by 6. And here, for example, if we can check for the wear number 4, 5, 6, and 7, we can see that if we lower the wears by 2 meter, we're going to increase the capacity of the wears. But actually, we have some strange value. If we look, for example, for lowering by 6, we can see that we have some strange value. This is explained by the fact that the wears, the maximum level or the maximum press level of the wear is 6 meter. So when we lower the wear by 6 meter, it means then that we're removing the wears. So somewhere in the formula that we're using, we're taking in account the geometry of the wear. So if we calculate the capacity of the wear without any wear, so it means that we're not going to have an accurate result. So, but we just wanted to show you that when we lower the level of the wear, we're going to increase the capacity of each wear. So here you can see the longitude profile for each simulation for the 1994 event in 2011 and the theoretical PPRI event. So we can see that there is a difference between each scenario. So we can see here that for the PPRI theoretical event, we have a lot of flood compared with the 2001 and the 1994, especially in the middle of our river, which is the wear number 5, 6, and 7. So for the 1994 flood, for the existing condition in the lowering 2, 4, and 6, we can see that when we're decreasing the level of the wear, we're decreasing the water level. So that's clearly shown here in those pictures that the water level is decreasing by decreasing the level of each wear. That's the same thing for the 2011. And here we can see that we have no more flood. But for the PPRI theoretical event, we can see that even if we lower the waves, we have flood in the middle part of the river. So there is just a little view of our perception. And I just want to add that we use the roughness coefficient in the cross section. We use the triplet zone approach in the Mach 11 to put the roughness coefficient. So we divided the cross section by three zones. We took the upper zone and we affected roughness coefficient according to what we have seen in the field and according to the Google Earth pictures. So we chose roughness coefficient for the upper part, for the middle part, and for the lower part, for each cross section, of course. So here we can compare the results for the current situation and for the lowering. We can see that the water level is decreasing. And here we can have a brief approach of lowering the level of the wells and its effect with the water depth. So we can see here for each well that when we are lowering the wells, we are decreasing the water depth. That's the same thing for the PPRI theoretical event. Okay, now we are going to talk about the 2D model results.
Hello everyone. Let me show you. We can accept comments. Do you have any comments? Okay. First of all, due to limitations of the time, we just run the model with the scenario 4,500 cubic meters per second as the maximum event that it's proposed by the agency. So I will show you for the scenario one with the current state of the wheels. You can see that the flooding event is quite similar to the flood event present in 1994. And in this video you can see how is the threat of the proposal solution of lowering the wheels 2 meters. It's possible to see how the level of loading decreases, which is a little bit. But now we should compare with that scenario with lowering wheels 6 meters. We can see how the impact of lowering the wheels 6 meters is really, you can see it as clear as possible. One of the consequences of lowering the wheels are here we can compare the three scenarios. We can see how the impact of changing the elevation, the height of the wheels is an efficient solution in order to reduce or even to avoid the flood events in the catchment of the lower one. Some recommendations. Okay, we talk about the impacts of removing the wheels, but there are some structural issues that we have not talked about that. For example, reinforcing the embankments, because we consider that it's not a solution as feasible, as sustainable, it could be lowering the level of the wheels. Lowering the wheels also will impact in restoring the sediment transport at its natural condition that the river, well, everybody knows that it's impossible to restore the natural condition along the river because we have infrastructure built both sides, but this measure that it's already taken is increasing and it will increase the discharge capacity of the river. So we had this presentation, this Leslie presentation last Tuesday, and we can assure that lowering the wheels is an effective solution in order to increase the capacity of the river. Thank you so much.
Okay, questions?
First, just one small comment, I think you need to check your site more practice before, because at the beginning in the presentation you go forward and come back so many times, it's quite confusing. And also, yes, this page, I cannot understand what's the meaning of the capacity of each wheel.
So the capacity, the maximum discharge it can go through each wheel.
Ah, the maximum discharge. Okay.
For me, I have one question. Slide number 20. Regarding the results of your 2D modeling, so how do you explain what you are analyzing results? And apparently, the riverbed is dry in Vietnam.
Okay, this legend is set up for just showing the flooded part, not all the river, not all the water in the river.
Okay, so it means before you set up your model with Hadoop, you had the first simulation with constant discharge for a certain amount of time to fill the riverbed. Then after, you enter the Hadoop, or did you extend the Hadoop in order to have the riverbed with water?
Sorry, can you repeat? We use the complete hydrograph for the event.
Yes.
And we focus on the 2D model in order to get.
So I think your riverbed was dry, and then you were running the model with a dry riverbed. So there was something not really clear to be checked.
Okay. But you can check our model results. It's not because it's because it's in order to focus on the result of the flooding event. It's not for the realist. It's not black.
That was very interesting. Just to clarify, when you are simulating the channel with the weirs, weir height lowered, are you using the existing channel profile, or are you relying for the fact that the bed will change through erosion or deposition, that the bed elevation, the bed profile will change with the change in height of the weir?
Okay.
Or is it significant? Maybe it's not significant.
Professor James, what I understood about your question is, for example, in the current situation, we didn't change only the wheel, because we have to also adjust the slope, part of the slope, in order to represent accurately the situation. Yes. But we didn't change dramatically the slope, because
no, we have to remove the deposition, the sort of pile of sediment behind the wheel, that's gone.
Yes. And you have to take into account that an existed study on this study is to execute a sediment transport study in order to have a visible representation of the reality.
Thank you.
Can you go back to slide number 21 or 22 is okay as well? Yeah. So at first, what is your downstream boundary condition?
The boundary condition downstream
is the water sea level at minus 0.5. It's a water sea level. It's a water level.
It's a close boundary condition.
Okay, and for sure you have not removed the bridge in the riverbed. Because you see you have white part.
Yes, you're right. We didn't have enough time to remove the structures.
And to ask again about what you had in the river, have you done a hot start? Have you generated something with water inside your river before running your...
No, we did a hot start model.
How can you lower the weir number one, which is about 70 centimeters high, and if you lower it for 2 or 6 meters, it will be the riverbed will be a couple of meters below sea level.
But we didn't lower the weir number one. We lowered just the weir number 5, 6, and 7.
Okay.
Just to make the things clear, you use my 21 or my 12?
My float. As a compass.
So then I think it's more clear for
yeah,
so it means you have Mike 11 model for the river bed itself, and you are representing the flooding in Mike 21. But I think it has to be said because When you show the results, I think for almost everyone in the room, when we look at the river, it's dry. So this is why you had so many questions. And okay. This is for making the link with the presentation which is coming just after.
Yes.
How you communicate it to the general public, if you show that, for all the people in the room, they will say, it's not possible, yes. Because here you get water downstream and you get water upstream. So this is not the results you can present. So at least you should explain what's below, and even with that, I'm not that sure that's how you represent the flooding, and it's still something which is not
completely clear
for me, how you are moving from Mike 11 to Mike 21 in this tension. Okay.
Yeah, it has to be said that the coupling method for Mike 11 plus Mike 21 is not so accurate. But we couldn't get results with only Mike 21.
If I understand well, it means that most of the time when you get water on the map, means that the river is not at the right place. This is why you have overflow. So if you have overflow in the upstream part, it means the river bed is not properly exactly at the axis of Mike 11.
No, we checked that. We checked that, and because when you link, when you do the link between the coupling, say.
I'm pretty sure this is this. Okay, but anyway. Okay, good. More questions or comments? No? Yes, please.
For the definition of weir, you say that.
Weir is a structure no more to the flow path. Yeah, not always.
Not always. Could be lateral.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you. Let's move to the team number 3, please.
I think they checked the location, but they didn't check the elevation of cross section.